All right, good afternoon, everyone. The clock in the back says it's 10 past two. It's 10 past two somewhere. Welcome, everyone. I'm Nikkei Blake. I happen to be the graduate dean and the vice provost of student academic affairs. And it is my absolute pleasure to convene the fifth Postdoc Slam here at UCSF. There you go. One of the few gifts of the pandemic was the harnessing of the power of technology to share events like this beyond the walls of this room. And therefore, we want to just welcome as well our teammates who are at Mission Bay campus and indeed across the country. I am going to guess that some of our participants today have family watching in wherever, well beyond the limits of the state of California. So welcome to everyone who is with us online. Just gonna do a land acknowledgement so you can pay your attention for a minute. Our campus in San Francisco, I'm sorry, as many of us gather here in person in place, on our campus in San Francisco, we want to acknowledge the Ramaytush Ohlone people who are the traditional custodians of our land. We pay our respects to the Ramaytush Ohlone elders, past, present, and future, who call this place the land that UCSF sits upon, their home. We are proud to continue their tradition of coming together and growing as a community. We thank the Ramaytush Ohlone community for their stewardship and support, and we look forward to strengthening our ties as we continue a relationship of mutual respect and understanding. Thank you. All right, we are so glad to be able to bring this event to you after a two-year break. And I'm guessing you are glad too. So if you're not in the room, I see people, I see props, and I hear people just bursting at the seams to shout and cheer on their contestants. So we're looking forward to having a great time this afternoon. Postdoc Slam, for those of you, if this is your first time, is part of UCSF's celebration of the National Postdoc Association Week, which began on Monday. Our sincere thanks to all our postdocs in the room. If you're a postdoc, just wave at me. Just wave at me if you're a postdoc. Look at that, all right? Our postdocs are a critical part of the mission here at UCSF, so just know that we appreciate you. We don't always tell you, but we do. We do appreciate you. Thank you for all that you do. If you're not a postdoc and you're sitting next to a postdoc, just give them a tap and say, good job. Yeah, just tap them and say, good job. Yeah. All right. So National Postdoc Week is organized by your postdoc association. Are there members of the postdoc board in here? I think I see at least one. There are more than one. Let's give them a round of applause. So if you don't know it yet, they have worked under the guidance of our AVC Bill Lindstedt. They have worked tirelessly to come up with 20 events this week. Help them. And I've been to a few of them, and it's not bad. So if you have a chance, there's still two more days left. If you have a chance, if you're a postdoc, go mingle with other postdocs. Take the opportunity to mingle with other postdocs. All right, today you will hear from a fraction of the postdocs here on this campus. You'll hear from 10 of them. There are about 1,100 postdocs on campus. Postdocs entered the Postdoc Slam contest by submitting their talks and video. A group of screening judges comprising of faculty and staff reviewed the videos and then chose these 10 finalists. These postdocs have been working very hard to make their talks as engaging as possible? Of course. The lucrative prize money is also part of the lure for this. First prize is $4,000. That's a nice chunk of change. Second prize, comfortably at $2,000. Third prize, not too shabby at $1,000. And then you as the audience will get the opportunity to pick your people's choice. And the People's Choice Award is set at $750. So who doesn't like to give away money? Here we go. As an audience, you will be able to participate in the trivia. So after each presentation, the judges will do what judges do. And as they do what judges do, we are going to engage you in a trivia competition. Guess what? There are also prizes for the trivia. Now, it's not $4,000. Okay, but there will be prizes for the trivia. No competition happens without judges, and I want to take the opportunity now to just introduce our five judges this evening. As I call your name, will you please just stand so that the audience can acknowledge you? So first off is our UCSF's own superstar, Peter Ching-hyung, assistant associate dean and professor in the School of Medicine, and one of UCSF's most visible and effective communicators throughout the COVID-19 pandemic. Peter. second judge, Sonia Chandri. I think that's right, Chandri, yes, Chandri, there you go. Specialist in the Department of Medicine here at UCSF and grand prize winner of this very event in 2018, Chandra. Third judge is Mina Kim, award-winning reporter and host of the 10 a.m. statewide hour of KQED Public Radio's Forum Program, a daily talk show on a wide range of topics of interest of people in the Bay Area. Excellent. Number four, our own Renee Navarro, UCSF's first Vice Chancellor of Diversity and Outreach and Professor of Anesthesiology and Preoperative Care. And Dr. Navarro is joining us as a second-time judge. Thank you. But there's more. In 2018, she actually served as the judge for Chandra. So there you go. She knows how to pick a winner. And then last but by no means least, Catherine Nielsen, director of UCSF Science and Health Education Partnership, now celebrating its 35th year and co-founder of the Bay Area Science Festival. All right, the judges will be looking at these basic qualities in the presentations. Did the presentation help you understand the research? Was the topic and its significance communicated using language appropriate to an educated but non-specialized audience? And did the presentation make you want to know more about the research? Each talk will be timed, and any presentation that goes over 3 minutes will be disqualified. No pressure. by the way, our official timer is UCSF's registrar, Doug Carlson. I gotta brag a little bit. Doug actually got to be the timekeeper at the NCAA tournament this year. So he's famous too. You just don't see him. He's in the background kind of a famous. All right. Finally, I need you to silence your cell phones. I know we don't think we can do without them, but just turn the little switch off. We all are going to be nice. We don't want anything to distract the presenters as they present. All right, judges, are you ready? Contestants, are you ready? All right, here we go. All right. The finalists drew numbers to determine the order in which they will speak. Our first speaker is David Moses, faculty member Edward Chang. Talk is entitled Restoring Lost Words, Building a Brain Implant to Help Patients Speak Again. David.
In 2003, a man named Pancho was involved in a tragic car crash that left him almost completely paralyzed. At the age of only 20, doctors told him that he had no chance of recovery. He would never walk or speak again. Nevertheless, he didn't lose hope that one day, somehow, he'd regain his ability to speak freely. My colleagues and I want to help Pancho and others with similar disabilities to achieve this dream. And so we started a clinical trial to see if we can help them speak again. We're thrilled to have Pancho as the first volunteer for this trial so that together we can start turning his dream into reality. In our approach, we implanted an array of electrical sensors over the surface of Pancho's speech motor cortex, which is the brain area that allows us to control our vocal tract and speak. Our goal is to translate the electrical signals from these sensors directly into the words that Pancho tries to say, bypassing his paralysis altogether. Now, if this sounds like an impossible challenge to you, then you're not far off. Pancho hadn't been able to speak for over 15 years, so we weren't even sure what we'd find in this brain area. The good news, though, is that we didn't have to start from scratch. In our lab, we've long believed that speech is our most efficient and expressive form of communication. There's a reason why we're all up here talking to you about our research today and not just texting it to you. Our fascination with speech led us to study the speech motor cortex extensively, learning how the patterns in this region give rise to spoken language. Using this knowledge, I showed that it's possible to turn these patterns into words as someone spoke, but I did this with people who were not paralyzed. Now I had to design a project to translate the technology to Pancho. To start, Pancho chose a set of 50 words and then repeated these words, tried to say them, many, many times. My colleagues trained artificial intelligence models to interpret the complex neural patterns that we observed as he tried to speak. Separately, I built tools to help us reject unlikely word sequences, similar to autocorrect features on your phone. I incorporated all of these components into a real-time system that I designed, and we let Pancho use the system to try to communicate in full sentences. After months of training, Pancho did the impossible. He tried to speak, and his words appeared on the computer screen, translated entirely from his brain signals. The first time in history this had ever been shown. He was so overcome with excitement, we almost had to pause our testing, but he managed to stay focused and use the system to generate a variety of sentences. Although this milestone is very encouraging, we still have a long way to go before the technology can be ready for clinical use cases. But with the help of incredible people like Pancho, I'm sure that we can continue to prove that his dream, which we share, really can become more than just a dream. Thank you.
I've only heard one, and I'm glad I'm not judging. All right. So as I indicated before, to give the judges some time, we're going to do a trivia. Are you ready? Are you sure? All right, here we go. Now, UCSF does not have a School of Arts and Sciences, but I hereby welcome you to the Postdoc Slam School of Arts and Science Trivia. For those of you who are viewing this event remotely, this for you is a little like Jeopardy. You get to scream at your TV, but you don't get to win any prizes. Okay, so this is just for the in-house folks. All right. So we have to have it's a little bit of a decorum. So when I read the question, if you know the answer, please raise your hand. Who are my spotters? Okay. So Jen and Holly are my spotters. So they will be their unbiased participants here. So they are the ones that will tell me whose hand got raised first. All right. Are you ready? All right. First slide. There we go. The guitarist of this band, with a succinctly regal name, received a PhD in astrophysics in 2007 from the Imperial College of London. Woohoo! Ooh. Uh-oh.
It was our actual professor who just spoke.
Is it
Brent? It is not. It is the Queen! Well done, and there is your prize. All right, let me give you a little bit of history about that question. The band, the Queen, and the guitarist is Brian May. Not only did May co-found one of the biggest bands in rock history and write such hits as We Will Rock You. Everybody know that? We will. Yeah. And The Show Must Go On. But he also completed his PhD in astrophysics in 2007 after a decades-long hiatus to focus on, you know, that profitable career being a band. Speaking of Queens, may she rest in peace, May was appointed the commander of the Order of the British Empire. This is like one level below knighting by Queen Elizabeth in 2005. He was a science team collaborator for NASA's New Horizons Pluto mission, and a co-founder for the Asteroid Day Awareness Campaign. So there you go. I didn't know there was a band named the Queen. I too am learning. Judges, are you ready? All right. Our second speaker is Amanda McQuaid.
You ain't nothing but a...
Our mentor is Martin Kampman, and the title is Interfering with Interfering.
When you get sick, like with a virus, your body responds to help protect you. This interferon response, as the name suggests, helps your body interfere with the viral replication and kill the infected cells. Recently, myself and others have found this same interferon response in a completely unexpected place, in the absence of viruses. And so I was really intrigued by this mystery. We found this response in the brains of people with Alzheimer's disease. And so I was confused. It's sort of like when your dog's barking at the door and you go to check, but no one's there. Why were these cells trying to attack a virus when there's no infection in the brain? And rather than merely barking, these cells were wreaking havoc. They were tearing apart the connections between the synapses, biting at the protective layers of our cells. Rather than provide a protection and warning, this immune response was damaging the brain. Now, in the case of a dog bark, it might be okay to check the door, see no one's there, and head back to the couch. But with diseases like Alzheimer's disease that affect millions of patients and their caretakers, we have to figure out what's going on. To do this, I've been studying the brain's immune cells in a controlled fashion to figure out what makes them tick. My goal is to find cellular factors that can interfere with interferon. I'm using a tool called CRISPR to inhibit cellular factors one by one and figure out which ones are capable of interfering with interferon. These cells then wouldn't bark, wouldn't attack the brain, and might actually represent a therapeutic for Alzheimer's disease. Already, I found a number of cellular factors that can interfere with interferon, and were known to do so from viruses, and will completely block this response. But I don't want to completely shut off the immune system. When there still is an intruder, I want my dog to bark. I'm looking for more of a trainer, something that can help my cells distinguish what's a real infection and when they can stay quiet. Excitingly, I've been able to find a number of cellular factors that were already known to be associated with Alzheimer's disease. We knew there was this association, but no one knew why these factors were causing your brain health to decline until now. It's possible that this interference with interferon is the mechanism of how these cellular factors are causing the brain to decline. I'm really excited to keep studying my hypothesis that interfering with interferon, telling the cells, down boy, there's no virus here, might help save your brain from an unnecessary attack. Thank you.
For those of you who can't see, there's like a Amanda thing going on over here. All right, judges are gonna do their thing. Question number two. I don't think I'm hitting anything, but let's see. Let's do that. And then let's go all the way back to there. Yes? And there. Well, okay. So no one's going to win that. Try. Go one. Oh, let me go back one. Sorry. There. Everybody know who that is? Everybody knows who that is? All right, we're just not gonna ask that one. It's because everybody knows who that one is. We'll how do we determine who gets the gift? We'll make it up at the end. How's that? The question, as you might imagine, who drew this image? And is one of the most iconic examples of the artistic scientist in the Western culture. And who is it? All right. Born in 1452 in Tuscan Hill in Vinci, Leonardo painted such mind-numbing famous works as the Mona Lisa and the Last Supper. But he is known for his notebooks, in which he makes drawings and notes on a variety of subjects, including anatomy, astronomy, botany, cartography, and many other topics. During his lifetime and for centuries after, his fame rested on his achievements as an artist. But today, we are celebrating him as an engineer, a scientist, and a theorist. There we go. And I will move my clipboard over there just in case and make sure that we don't mess this up again. All right, judges, are you ready? All right. Speaker number three is Hong Caratoville. Her faculty mentor is William Dugrodo, and her title of her talk is Going with the Flow, Protons on the Move.
The sour sensations you get when you bite into a pickle or taste a lemon are thanks to proton channel proteins, which move protons, the smallest ions, in and out of cells. The movement of protons in and out of cells not only helps you taste these sour foods, but also helps regulate the acidity of the cells in our bodies. Usually, protons move through these channels along chains of linked water molecules. However, in many high-resolution snapshots of natural proton channels, we typically see these greasy pockets that seem to block these water chains from forming. So, you know, water and grease don't mix. How do protons get across these greasy pockets? We hypothesize that these water chains can still form within these greasy pockets, but only momentarily, allowing for protons to pass, but preventing the passage of other ions. Testing this idea in natural proton channels has proven quite difficult. So we turn to protein design, where we take inspiration from nature to build brand new proteins. Through protein design, I can build artificial proteins from scratch to distill these complex natural proteins into model proteins where I have exact control over the chemistry of the entire system. So we started by building a completely greasy channel. If this channel is completely greasy, we see no proton movement because these linked water chains can't form. Now, I changed the chemistry of the channel by introducing these water stabilizing sites into these greasy pockets. High resolution photographs of these design channels show water that wasn't there before, and computer simulations show these linked water chains forming within these greasy pockets in the presence of a proton. And guess what? Our experiments now show that our design channels specifically move protons, just as we've designed them to. By simply adding these water stabilizing sites within these greasy channels, we are able to build these artificial bio-inspired proton channels to test this elusive mechanism. We now have a molecular level understanding of how protons move through these natural proton channels, through these linked water chains within these greasy pockets. And that kind of leaves you with a sour taste in your mouth. Thank you.
All right. So let's just give away the second prize now. I want to know who the youngest postdoc in the room is. So let's start at not age, postdoc age. Yeah. No, I wouldn't do that to you. I would not do that. Oh my, no. So if you've been up, how long?
2 weeks.
Oh my, anybody here? Yeah, welcome that young man to the UCSF. Excellent, all right. Next slide.
Try.
All right, I think we are there. The work of Susan Simard, a prominent Canadian forest scientist, strongly influenced this 2009 Pulitzer-winning tree-centric novel. Anybody? Yeah, that one was tough for me. Oh, good. I think our judge has an answer. Does anybody have an answer? Does anybody? Let's see first. Let's hear. Oh, look at that. Excellent. Oh, I'm sorry. The answer is the overstory. Thank you. All right. So long history about the overstory here. The ninth novel by American writer Richard Powers, The Overstory tracks 9 characters whose varied experiences and relationships with trees become intertwined to address the destruction of forests. Not only is Dr. Simard's research influential on the book, but she's also one inspiration for the character of Patricia Westerford in the novel. Anybody read this novel? Just out of curiosity, one and a half people. Okay. Simard is a pioneer on the frontier of plant communication and intelligence. Her research focuses on how the underground networks of fungi and roots in forests facilitate communication and interaction between trees, plants, and an ecosystem. Her work has revealed that forests have hub trees, or mother trees, which are large, highly connected trees that play an important role in the flow of information and resources in a forest. Okay, put that on your reading list. All right, ready, judges, or you need more time? Ready? All right, speaker number 4. Deepcho Mazumdar, faculty mentor Joseph Bondi Demoni, and David Agard. Ooh, I am struggling here. All right. Talk title, Slaying Deadly Bacteria with Giant Viruses.
In the backdrop of the COVID-19 pandemic, there is a global crisis that is silently on the rise. Ladies and gentlemen, we now live in a time where a handful of deadly bacteria cannot be treated with existing antibiotics. After nearly a century of keeping these bugs at bay, we are now in a losing battle. So, what do we do? Well, it turns out we're not the only ones in this fight. In nature, there are these viruses that have been fighting bacteria for eons. They exclusively infect bacteria and kill these bacteria. They're called phages or bacteriophages. That literally means bacteria eaters. And they're really good at doing this job. So we've turned to them for help. The catch-22 is that bacteria aren't exactly passive bystanders. Through eons of conflict, they have amassed an enormous arsenal of defense systems to counter these phage infections. Most ordinary phages at a given time can only counter maybe one or few of these bacterial defense systems, and this has been a significant bottleneck in using phages for therapy until now. Ladies and gentlemen, I introduce to you the hero of our story, Phi-KZ. This is an unusual kind of a phage called a jumbo phage. Jumbo owing to the enormous size of this bacteriophage. And oh boy, size matters. Here at UCSF, it was found in the labs of Joseph Bondi Denemi and David Agard that when faced with a highly infectious deadly bacteria, Pseudomonas aeruginosa, Phi-KZ can assiduously thwart pretty much every tested defense system in these bacterial systems. This makes Phi-KZ a potent killer of this bacteria, and is, in fact, as we speak, relatives of this phage are being used for clinical therapy. So how does Phi-KZ do its magic? Well, that's where I come in. Here at UCSF, working in collaboration with large research groups, I use a bunch of specialized techniques to study the modus operandi of this phage. I use a technique called mass spectrometry that lets me identify what sort of proteins this phage is using to fight bacterial defense systems. Side by side, I use a technique called cryo-electron tomography that lets me visualize at an extremely high resolution how these proteins are put together to form these complex machinery to fight bacteria. In simple terms, what I'm doing is trying to figure out what sort of guns and ammunition this amazing jumbo phage is packing and how it's assembling them and putting them together to fight bacteria. Why is this work critical? Well, not only because it stands to inform some fundamentally fascinating biology, but also because the findings of our studies will then help us engineer even more potent bacteriophages to combat all sorts of deadly bacteria. With that, I'd like to end by saying that when the drugs run out and the bugs take over, you'll know that you have a friend in these Herculean viruses and researchers like me who understand exactly what they do so that you and I have a better future. Thank you.
Fire away. This actress was an asteroid named after her, starred in the cult classic sci-fi TV series, and also volunteered her time to promote NASA's programs and recruit diverse astronauts, including women and ethnic minorities. No. Come on. Yes. Yes. Nichelle Nichols. Anybody remember Lieutenant Uhura? What? No Star Trek fans around? what is up? Okay. In her role as bridge officer, Uhura, the original Star Trek series, there are no Star Trek fans around? Boy, whew, gotta change that. TV series from 1966 to 1969, Nichols helped dismantle the racial stereotypes as one of the first black women featured in an empowered character in the major television series. She reprised her portrayal of Uhura in the 6 Star Trek film sequels. Former astronaut Mae Jemison has cited Nichols' role as Lieutenant Uhura as her inspiration for wanting to become an astronaut. Nichols, who died in July of 2022 at the age of 87, began her career as a singer and a dancer. You too can do great things. She will continue her journey when her ashes are launched into deep space aboard a rocket later this year. I know. All right. Speaker number 5. By the way, are you noticing the music that these guys are walking up to? It's kind of cool. All right. Neha Shroff, faculty mentor Ophir Klein, and her title of her talk is The Mechanics of Growth. May the pressure be with you.
Imagine yourself growing up from a tiny embryo to a baby to finally an adult. Would you ever think that mechanical forces regulate this process? Crazy, right? We know that early embryonic development is regulated by signaling factors called morphogens. These morphogens are secreted from specific locations called signaling centers from where they spread out and perform their magic. Without them, organs just wouldn't grow correctly. But what we do not know is how do some cells in a similar population of cells suddenly decide we will become signaling centers, regulate the development of everything around us. I chose to solve this problem using the mouse tooth because development of this organ is also regulated by a signaling center. We had a hint that mechanical forces might be involved in this process, but no one had ever thought of looking at this before or even knew how to. So we took a risk. I standardized a method to measure forces in the live tooth as it grows, and the hard work paid off. I stayed sane during the pandemic and also found out that as the tooth grows, the forces in it build up. Now, how does this happen? You may have seen or played with those toys that expand in size when they absorb water. Now imagine a constraint around that toy. It's trying to grow, but there is no space for the new material to go to. What will happen? There'll be increasing pressure at the center, right? And that is exactly what happens as the tooth grows. Cell proliferation is what causes a buildup in the number of cells in a constrained space, causing the pressure to build up inside the tooth. And here is the cool bit. The location of the signaling center is exactly at the center of this force field. So of course, I was like, oh my god, is there a connection? I went ahead, blocked cell proliferation, and what did I see? No force development, yeah, but also no signaling center formation. I have discovered how cell proliferation-driven pressure is what triggers the development of signaling centers and the expression of morphogens. And for all of you who are wondering, if it is pressure, can you externally induce pressure and cause the signaling center to form? The answer is yes. With my work, we are one more step closer to figuring out how to use mechanical forces to regulate the expression of morphogens and thus regulate tissue growth. Today, I want to leave you all with the hope of a world where you don't need invasive techniques, but rather maybe just a physiotherapist to solve your issues of aging and regeneration. May the pressure be with you. Thank you.
Ah, I am not even going to comment. I'm just going to leave it right there. This is amazing. You guys are amazing. All right. Trivia question number 5. His work is no mere walk in the park. This French painter's systematic exploration of pure color applied to canvas in small dots was influenced by the color of theories of 19th century chemist Michael Eugene Chevreul. Wow, yes, look at you, George Seurat. Well done. Seurat's approach to painting came to be known as pointillism due to the use of tiny dots of distinct colors all over the canvas. The technique relies on the ability of the eye and mind of the viewer to blend the color spots into a fuller range of tones. Pointillism had its heyday in the late 19th century, but Seurat's most famous painting, A Sunday Afternoon on the Island of La Grande Jatte, inspired a much-loved and lauded musical by Stephen Sondheim, Sunday in the Park with George. Anyone ever seen that? Yeah, a few. All right, a few of us. All right. Not sure if that says anything about my age, but all right, it's cool. Ready? Still thinking? Still thinking. Ready? Ready? All right. 5 and go. All right. Speaker number 6 is Sangeeth Akondoye. Faculty mentor Deepak Lambda, and the title of the talk is Can't See You Well. This scroll could help you.
We see few people born with a dimple on their cheeks. But have you heard about a dimple inside the eye? Yes, you heard me right. We all are born with a permanent dimple in the retinal tissue that lines at the back of the eye. And technically, we call this dimple as fovea. How this fovea is formed, we don't know. But what this fovea has is very precious. This fovea is exclusively loaded with cone cells which provides the daylight and the color vision. For example, if you're able to see me or if you're able to appreciate the colors in the room, it's simply because of the healthy cones which you have in this fovea. Now, as we grow older or due to any kind of genetic mutation, the cells in this fovea starts to die, leading to permanent blindness. And the goal of my research is to replace these lost cones with the new cones using cell transplantation therapy. And for this, we use squirrel as an animal model. Yes, the squirrel, which hops in our very own backyard, has now entered our lab for 3 reasons. 1, they do not have a dimple in their eye, but their whole retina is loaded with the cones, which mimics that tiny small region in the human eye. 2, the squirrel's eyes could be easily checked by taking high resolution microscopic images and by knocking them down safely for a few minutes. 3, through our collaborator, we have a well-funded facility of squirrels which makes them available for our research. To accomplish our initial feat, I grew the retinas in the lab. And these retinas are loaded with cones and they are tagged with green fluorescent protein. We injected these retinas into the damaged retina of the squirrel's eye. And after 6 months, what we saw was incredible. There were surviving green cone cells in the damaged squirrel's retina. With this initial feat of success, our next goal is to see if this squirrel can hop back into a backyard and see the nature again. And if they do, we want to apply this technology to humans,
to treat their blindness due to the loss of the cone cells. Thank you, and thank you for the healthy cone cells which helped you watch our beautiful story. One fun fact, these squirrels are called as 13-line ground squirrels because they have 13 lines on their back. Thank you.
I'm beginning to believe I'm gonna live a long, healthy life after all of this. All right. All right, next slide. This American agricultural scientist called the Black Leonardo by Time Magazine. Okay, everybody can read. So go ahead. The famous and the infamous, yes, sir, George Washington Carver. No clap for him, just because he did it. Thank you. Carver, who was one of the most prominent scientists of the early 20th century, tackled issues of his day from both an artistic and a scientific point of view. Carver studied crop rotations, patented medicinal uses for peanuts, and designed a Jessup wagon that served as a mobile classroom to teach farmers revolutionary agricultural practices to achieve higher crop yields and healthier soils. He began drawing and painting as a youth and continued to make art throughout his life. Carver not only created pigments from natural products of his own work, but he also created a line of household paints using pigments from Alabama soil that he envisioned would be more affordable for poor families. All right. Judges are still working a little bit. Love silence. All right. Ready? Yes? Yeah. I can give you more time if you need more time. Take your time. This is a tough job. How much are we paying you again? All right. I'm at number, this is number 7 of 10. Irina Ojeda, faculty mentor, Max Natchier. Title of the talk is One Here to Rule Them All.
We're made up of cells. But did you know that most of the cells of your body have a tiny hair-like antenna? Yes, an antenna also known as cilium, which is loaded with receptors to detect unique signals and perform the coolest functions in your body. You don't believe me? Well, you can see me because the photoreceptor cells in your eyes detect light through their cilia. The cilium enables our olfactory cells to detect smells. One hair for detecting signals, one hair to rule them all, one hair that happens to be so slim that they are completely devoid of synthesis machinery. Which is a bummer, you know, because what that means is that all those receptors cannot be created inside. They have to be carried in by small molecular tracks to enable detection and out for signal termination. Now, the cilium can also convey the information of how much energy reserves we have in our body and modulate hunger. I'll tell you how. Our energy reserves, that is our fat cells, produce a hormone called leptin. Leptin travels through the bloodstream to the brain, where it puts to sleep neurons that produce a chemical signal for hunger and awakes neurons that produce a chemical signal for satiety. These signals are relayed to another neuron and are detected by its cilium. Both the receptor and the cilium are so critical that if they are experimentally ablated in these cells, the capacity to stop feeling hungry is lost. And chances are you cannot stop eating and you develop obesity. That's why my research project focuses in finding out how the receptor goes in or out of the cilium, depending on what signal it is bound to.
The caveat is that I cannot do this directly in the neurons in the brain because, well, there are not that many and these movements are rather fast. So to overcome that problem, I designed receptor blueprints and stuffed them into cells that are way easier to handle. These cells have everything I need, the cilium, the receptor, and the molecular tracks that drive it in and out. So I just need to, you know, toss the hunger and satiety signal like salt and pepper to a salad and observe what's going on with the receptor. What I have found is that the hunger signal concentrates the receptor at the cilium, whereas the satiety signal makes the cilium recycle the receptor back to the cell. Now I have a conundrum. We need the hair intact, yet we need the receptor to exit the hair to get leaner. Why do we need the hair at all? How does your brain get to say, I'm full, thank you? I'm in my lab trying to unravel this mystery, because if we crack it, we may be able to tailor better therapies against obesity. Such big impact hidden in such a tiny hair. One hair to rule them all. Thank you very much.
All right. Question. All right, I'm gonna finish reading that. Watch out. We have an artist scientist right here at UCSF. UCSF surgeon and neuroscientist composed and performed an original piece of music to accompany the 2021 virtual UCSF State of the Union address. You thought it was? Yes. Yes. Well done. I remember they invited me to that town hall when they recruited me. It was impressive. It was impressive. All right, Dr. Lam is a professor of otolaryngology at UCSF, and he specializes in the treatment of ear disorders. He has also researched the neural basis of musical creativity. He runs the Sound and Music Perception Lab at UCSF, where they have used creative activities such as musical jazz, improvisation, cartoon sketching, and freestyle rapping. That sounds like a fun lab, doesn't it? In combination with functional MRI and EEG to study the creative process in real time. Dr. Lim's composition and performance for the 2021 State of the University address was entitled Catalyst. Lim has remarked that he wanted the music to express my gratitude toward the remarkable community here at UCSF, which has provided much needed solace and leadership during the challenging times for our entire world. That it did. All right, seven down. Number eight. Now remember, guys, you get to do the People's Award too, right? So you should be taking notes too. All right, I know I took a long time to remind you of that, but you have to remember, you have to vote. All right, our eighth speaker is Jian Long Li, faculty mentor Sarah Knox, and the title of the talk is Nerve Against Gray Hair.
Nerve is critical for us to communicate with the world, but have you ever thought that it's also important for damage rescue? Today, I'm going to talk about a way to prevent our body from damage with signals from the nerve, taking the hair as an example. As we all know, radiotherapy is one of the most common treatments for patients with cancers. Although advancement has been achieved over the years, there are still substantial side effects. As we can see from the pictures shown on the left, hair becomes gray or even white within radiation area. Now, the question is, can we prevent this from happening? To investigate what happens to gray hair, we took the skin sample from area receiving radiation as well as from area without radiation. The hair is produced by a specific tissue called hair follicle, and the pigmented hair is maintained by a group of cells called melanocytes. Both the activities of hair follicle and melanocytes are regulated by a nerve. Surprisingly, we found one of the major differences in the pigmented and gray hair is the nerve supply. Nerve supply is dramatically lost upon radiation. Therefore, if we treat with chemicals that promote nerve supply, can we prevent pigmented hair becoming gray? From the pictures shown on the right, we can see that the answer is yes. To sum up, radiated hair becomes gray due to the loss of nerve supply, and if we treat with neuronal cues to restore nerve supply, we can stop gray hair. Are there more applications? Yes. We also found that this protective effect is not only in the hair, but also to stop dry mouth and dry eye disease. And my hair is getting gray, and this may help me. What about you? Thank you.
Yeah, I'm not so sure your hair is getting gray. We'll just say that. You got a ways to go. All right, trivia question number 8. This Berkeley-born 20th century author was the first woman to win. Oh, okay. Let me just look up. Was the first woman to win the Hugo and Nebula Awards for Best Novel, wrote classic works of spectacular fiction that were strongly influenced by social sciences such as sociology and anthropology. Who is it? There you go. It's actually pretty funny because in my notes, this is the only question for which there is a hint. Who needs a hint when you have UCSF postdocs in the room? No one needs a hint. Okay. Le Guin, whose writing career spanned 60 years, grew up in Berkeley as the child of two anthropologists. While many hard science fiction writers were drawn to physics, astronomy, and chemistry, Le Guin was more interested in biology, social sciences, psychology, as well as issues of race, gender, and sexuality. Her classic 1969 novel, The Left Hand of Darkness, won both the Hugo and Nebula Awards in 1970 and is considered among the first works of a feminist science fiction. All right. We're almost there. Shake it off. We're almost there. Speaker number 9 is Sophie Huddart. Her faculty mentor, I'm going to mess this up, is Adithi Katumanchi. I apologize in advance for that. I'm pretty sure I just messed it up. Title talk is Cracking the Cough Code, Acoustic Epidemiology for Tuberculosis Diagnosis.
We've all spent the past few years paranoid about cough. Was that a normal cough? Or a COVID cough? Or just a cold? Am I coughing more today than I did yesterday? I have actually taken to carrying a continuous cough monitoring device in my pocket everywhere that I go. It is my smartphone. Smartphone-based continuous cough monitoring means it's possible for us to know exactly when we cough. We can even record the sound of the cough itself. My work looks at how we can use this information to diagnose disease. Now, diagnosing with cough isn't new. The last time you went to a doctor with a cough, they might have described it as wet or dry or hacking. We know that we can hear things in cough that help us diagnose disease. But there is so much more hidden in your cough, more than the human ear can hear. And this information can hold the key to figuring out what's making you sick. Our team works to improve the diagnosis of people with tuberculosis, or TB. TB is a bacterial disease that predominantly attacks the lungs and has a hallmark symptom of cough. TB is curable, but it requires quick and accurate diagnosis to start life-saving treatment. The problem is our current diagnostic tools suck. They can take weeks to get a result, and our best tests can miss half of TB patients. This failure to diagnose is part of the reason that more than 1 million people died last year from this treatable disease. Diagnosing TB using only a smartphone would be a game changer. Our team has already shown that a TB cough is distinct from coughs caused by other diseases, even COVID-19. But a single cough still doesn't give us perfect accuracy. This is where I come in. I love to look at how variables behave across time. I believe that by looking at how the frequency and timing of cough, even the sound of the cough itself, change in a week, we can better pick out which patients have TB. We recently asked coughing patients to record a week's worth of cough. I showed that the TB patients coughed twice as much as other sick people. What's more, they coughed at unique times in the day. My goal is to use these unique cough characteristics to develop a smartphone-based TB cough diagnostic. With this work, we could change how people with TB and other respiratory diseases are diagnosed. We wouldn't have to pinch and prod them and send samples away for testing. We could tell them, with just this smartphone, we can crack the code hidden in your cough.
I'll never think of my phone the same way again. All right. Trivia question number 9. What is this and where is it? Is that fair? Is that where is Eric? Is that a fair answer?
Yeah.
Yes? Okay. All right. Yes. All right. So here you're going to learn something. We're not just going to call it the sculpture outside the quad anymore. It's the dream catcher. There you go. A monumental steel sculpture in the Coret Quad at UCSF's Mission Bay campus. This massive 15-ton sculpture features a stable base that supports a weathering-like structure that moves even in gentle breezes. At home since 2015 in the middle of UCSF's Mission Bay Research Campus, it is literally art amid science. Known for his monumental metal sculpture, De Suevo grew up in the Outer Sunset in San Francisco, studied at City College of San Francisco, and graduated from Berkeley in 1957. Jean Robertson, who with her husband Sandy donated the sculpture to UCSF, remarked that the name Dreamcatcher aptly describes the spirit of the innovative work of scientists at Mission Bay. De Suevo himself said of the sculpture, "I had to imagine that piece before I got it started. Usually, you don't get 6 tons turning with wind." Well done. All right. Last, but by no means least, Elise Marchand, faculty mentor Eric Hong, and the title of the talk is Who Killed the Neurons?
Hi everyone, I'm so happy to be here today. I feel fortunate because I could work here I can talk to you, and I'm confident that I won't suddenly get undressed in front of all of you for no reason. Unfortunately, if I had frontotemporal dementia, I wouldn't be so sure of that. Indeed, patients with dementia can present symptoms such as motor, speech, and behavior impairment. They know that they might die in their 50s or 60s, and there is no cure to treat them. Clinicians and researchers have correlated the symptoms of those patients with some death of neurons in their brain. Why those neurons are dying? We don't know. So my job as a postdoc is to act as a detective. And I'm asking, who killed the neurons? To answer that question, I studied the brain of people that die of dementia using a cutting-edge technology called single-cell RNA sequencing. These techniques allowed me to have a snapshot of the crime scene. And I can ask, which neurons were dying? And what were the cells surrounding them doing at that time? My first result was that the usual suspect, the microglia, can actually kill neurons in the human brain. But a big surprise was that there is another suspect, the astrocyte. The astrocyte are a brain cell known to be the best friend of the neuron. Why? Because they support them in diverse contexts. For example, when two neurons want to communicate, they make contact and form a space called the synapse. There, they exchange information through small molecules called neurotransmitters. The role of the astrocyte is to buffer the excess of neurotransmitter, thanks to some specialized gates that they have. I found that these astrocytes lose the function of their gates, leading to a toxic accumulation of the neurotransmitter at the synapse that further lead to the degeneration of the neurons. So to further validate and prove that indeed the astrocyte can kill the neurons, I decided to reproduce the crime scene in a petri dish. In collaboration with two other labs at UCSF, I grew spheres of healthy neurons that I transplanted with disease astrocytes. And I found that indeed those disease astrocytes can target the synapse of the neurons and lead to their degeneration. So in conclusion, by following the trail of the killer of the neurons, I found that there is not only one killer, the microglia, but a second killer, the astrocyte, the traitors, and I could narrow down the weapon that they use to the gates that buffer the neurotransmitter. I hope that my work will provide new ideas for drug discovery for this devastating disease that is frontotemporal dementia. Thank you.
All right. I'd like to invite all the finalists back up on stage, will you? And judges, I know you're judging. All right, judges, I know that you're judging, but I need you to come take a picture with them. Can I get you to just take a picture with them? Yeah. So I probably need two lines because, where is Nancy? I need two lines so that the photographer can get you all. All right, ladies and gentlemen, why don't we just celebrate our contestants? All right, she's coming. I just saw her. She's coming. Here she comes. All right, one with just the contestants and one with the judges. And duck, Mary, duck. I'm just kidding.
Everybody kind of faces this way. Yeah, it comes forward on that.
There you go. And the judges, if you would just stay right there, everybody, let the judges just fill in if you will. There you go.
Okay.
There you go. There you go. All right. So I wanted to do that now instead of at the end, because when somebody wins $4,000, you can't say nothing to them. Okay, so we're just not gonna try. All right. Just want to say to the finalists, really, you guys did an outstanding job. So thank you for both entertaining and educating us today and reminding us of why being at UCSF is such an awesome, awesome place. Thank you. All right, audience. It's your time to play judge. Are you ready? The judges are going to be escorted out. There you go. It's your time to play judge. So you are going to vote for your favorite talk to win the People's Choice Award. And there's a URL somewhere. Is it going to go up? Okay. Oh, I see. I'm sorry. They're telling me that. So hold on. It's coming. The link will only be open for 10 minutes. So you get 10 minutes to vote. Those of you who are voting remotely will see the link right under the video in your browser, and you can take a minute to think about it. But again, you only have 10 minutes. Starting now. All right, while you vote, we're gonna... All right, the judges are coming back in. You guys worked them really hard, so thank you. Okay, thank you. Eric will give those to me. All right, welcome back. And where's the Amanda sign? Oh, it's still there. Okay, I'm like, where's the Amanda sign? All right. Welcome back, everyone. Thank you for your patience. As you might imagine, that was a very tough job that the judges just went through, so it took a little while. Before we proceed, however, I just want to, you know, I don't know that you guys appreciate how much work this is. And I want to, first of all, just thank Eric Rothman, who is... This, when you see him, just give him a hug. This young man has just put out a labor of love, putting this together. But Eric will be the first to tell you that he did not do this alone. He had an army of volunteers. So if you're in the room and you volunteered for Postdoc Slam, can you just stand up or wave your hand if you're standing already, and let's just appreciate them as well. All right, couldn't go without a plug for OCPD postdocs. If you haven't been to OCPD yet, go check them out. You should. They can help you. All right. And now I'll stop talking and I'll start giving out money. First of all, I want to announce the People's Choice winner. And much like the Grammys or the Oscars, it is sealed. I will now break the seal. And you know what? Can I just have the judges come up? Let's have the judges come up, and you can, yeah, you can. Why not? Yeah, come up so that you can congratulate the winner.
But remind them that this one is from the audience.
Yes. So this award is your pick. And the winner of the People's Choice Award is Sangeetha Kendohi. Do I have a check? All right, just take
just shake hands and have a picture.
There you go. Here. I'm sorry. I'm going to guess that money's going to be direct deposit somewhere. Oh, there you go.
Yes, it's just like two coins for a
Okay. All right. The third prize winner of $1,000 is, and I'm just gonna let one of you read it. How is that? And then, there you go.
Oh my God, okay. The winner of third prize is Sophie Hutter.
All right, and the winner of the $2,000 second place contestant for the Postdoc Slam 2022 is...
She's the radio announcer. So the second prize winner is Deepto Mozumdar.
And now, your 2022 Postdoc Slam winner is... Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you, judges. We appreciate it. I just want to say thanks again to the judges. It was a very, very difficult decision for them. But thank you for your time and for your engagement today. We genuinely appreciate you all. Thank you. All right, that brings us to the end of the show. Please congratulate the winners, take lots of pictures, and enjoy the rest of your evening. Thanks, everyone.